Good afternoon, everyone. It's my proud privilege to host this very unusual discussion with a very unusual personality, a personality who has led a very, very interesting life before coming to literature. I have with me Mr. Agnish Sridhar, who's a very well-renowned Kannada writer and is also involved with the film world. And I also have a very well-known personality from the Kannada world of letters and the English world of letters, Pratibha Nandakumar, poet and translator. We're going to be talking about Mr. Sridhar's interest in literature, writing, his literary influences, and later on in this session, we hope we will be talking about his latest book, and we will launch the cover of his latest book. Let me begin with a simple question to Mr. Sridhar. Sir, given your background, right, you were involved with the underworld, you have not been shy about admitting it, you have not been shy about talking about it. How did you get involved in literature, writing, reading and all of that? We hear of people from the underworld involved in films and other glamorous things, but writing, a life of the mind, a life of the intellect, how did you get there, sir?
Mr. Karthik, your question itself indicates that I was in the underworld and at some point I decided to write, develop interest in literature, in the letters. Now, most of the people think like that because the dominant aspect of my personality is the underworld, naturally. But actually, I entered underworld after I attained mastery over literature, mastery over worlds. By the time I entered into the underworld, already I had read all the best writers in the world. It all commenced by the age of 7. I was proverbially thin. Proverbially thin. My sister and brother, they were normal. So they used to call me in Kannada, Anchukaddi. Anchukaddi means the smallest possible. You know it, it's not thread-like. So by the age of 7, I thought I'm not fit to deal with other children of my age, youngsters of my age. So I used to sit at the corner of a room and start reading books. It's, of course, it was Kannada only. Till the age of 20, most of it was in Kannada. Like the kids stuff, Chandamama, Balamitra, Ramayana, Mahabharata. By the age of, I think, 15, 16, I was an expert in all these mythological characters. So by the time I reached about 25, 26, my brother was attacked by a rowdy. My brother was studying at Kanakapura. By that time I was a student of law in Bangalore and I was working with a literary giant of Kannada language, that is Mr. P. Lankesh. That time my brother was attacked by the then dreaded rowdy. When I went to give a complaint, the officer said, "It's of no use, Mr. Sridhar. He took a liking for me. You are an educated man. If you give the complaint now, if you register it tomorrow, Kotwal will come and force you to withdraw. Not only that, all the expenses he incurs on advocates, he will try to extract from you. So what can I do, sir? Okay, I will not give the complaint. What can I do? Because the same day, about 8 boys were attacked. Then he said, go and kill him. Kill him in the streets. We will help you. Department. I said, can't you do it? No, he is being supported by the political leaders, by the government. Then I took it seriously. See, this is where the literature, this is the where literature or my studies come into my help. They said, just go through this. Use all your intelligence, all cunning, all willpower. Achieve it. Because I was very hurt. Only brother I had. He had come to see India-Pakistan match. He was a cricketer. He could have become a great cricketer. Then I took it seriously and it took me. It is not an easy thing. It is not like as they show in films, go break somebody's this one. No, it takes lots of preparation and lots of work, intense work. I took about 7 years. Ultimately, I achieved it. I don't feel bad about it. I feel bad that my brother was attacked. I had to come into this path. In my personal history, it was almost like a destructive path. But there also, even in jail, I was very serious about my habit of reading books. Let me share one such incident. I was in the jail for about 1 year, 8 months for Kotwal case. And for more than 1 year, I was with my boss, that then Don, that is Jairaj, in the hospital. It is easy saying something about your health, you can be in the hospital. There's a jail ward. And usually why people get admitted to the jail ward was, they could use some time to pursue their activities. And Jairaj used to go out once in a week, taking the police with him. And he was asking me, why you don't want to go? I knew he was going to prostitutes and he was going for bars. Then they were forcing me. Sridhar, you are in the underworld. You are not asking me even one day to go out even for 1 hour. He used to go out for 5-6 hours. I thought I should go out. So on one day I said, I am ready.
He got the interrupt thought. You? Yeah. Did you say you wanted to go to a bookshop?
Yeah. No, you are just killing the bird. No, allow me. So the car, one person was there by name Samson, a right hand of Mr. Jairaj. He bought the car and we went out at 4 o'clock. He said we have to come back at 10. Now you will come a bit earlier. They were curious. Jairaj and all the others were curious. Where would he go? Which bar? Or which prostitute's house? Or any other girlfriend? This exactly is the point. Then I told him, I want to go to MG Road. We reached there. They thought, since I'm an educated man, I have some connections in MG Road. MG Road is considered as elite road. Then I went to Gangaram. Samson asked me, what is there? No, I want to purchase a couple of books. He thought for another half an hour, he may be there. It used to close at 8 o'clock. But I made them to open it till 8:20. I purchased books worth about 4,000 or 5,000 at that time in 87. I came back. Then he said, you don't want to go, at least go to some hotel? I said, no, I'm comfortable there.
What did the policeman say?
Because that used to give me much more pleasure than going to anywhere in the world. Even today, my time, I don't waste, not a question of information. I just immerse in going to something which attracts my mind. For me, mind is everything.
So what did the policeman say when you came back with all these books?
No, the police were happy. They told me, when these people go to some bar and other things, they were scared that somebody may inform the police. Mm-hmm. That time, these phones were there, iPhones were there.
Mm-hmm.
So they were worried. In my case, they were happy. They said, even if a police officer comes to a bookstall and look at you, they won't reprimand us. Yeah, of course, I did not go again. I cherish those moments, even today.
Okay, I'm going to follow up with your next question. So, did you ever have a chance to discuss books, literature with any policemen? Because many policemen write books.
Lots of policemen. Police job is the most insensitive job in the world. The moment they wear that uniform, though, they consider everybody criminal and they lose their sensitivity. But when they are not in their dress, when you meet them on one-to-one basis, most of them are interested. In history, in books, in political developments, in all the things, like any other normal human being. They used to appreciate, they used to follow me every week when I used to write in my Agni.
Right. So did you ever recommend books to a policeman saying, read this, read that?
I had given books to lots of IPS officers, not ordinary officers, about Buddha, about Basavanna, because I'm very much interested in the spiritual paths that humans have taken. About Sufis, I've given books. Not only I recommended books.
Right. Not too many people would know, since your book about the spiritual path is in Kannada, right? Can you spend a couple of minutes talking about that book of yours?
No, if I start talking about it, that time will look too very short.
Mm-hmm.
If I just tell
briefly
them not
what that book is about. And
see, one side. Of, see, I was two personalities. One side was in the violent world. But Kartik, when I ask people about the definition of non-violence, they simply say that it is a peaceful coexistence. No, it is not like that. It is much, much beyond that, much deeper than that. A man, recognizing the spirit of man in all the men, that is my idea of non-violence. So I knew about these things, the spirit of humans. But at the same time, I was in the underworld. Just because I knew about the spirit of man, and I'm quite interested in literature and philosophy, I couldn't have been ineffective because the question of my life and my death. Every day I had to see my death. So at the same time, I knew that people planning for my killing me, for my death, are not in any way worse than me. They were not bad than me. So the only way was to alleviate it, to counter it. As a compensation, I was deeply in the spiritual path. I was in Tarapit for many nights and Varanasi many nights. I have met people, interacted with people who are much larger than life, who are totally involved in it. And one such young lady was introduced herself, her name as Sony. When I used to address her Sony, I was in my 40s, she was in 20s. She used to say, no, call me Sony Ma. Call me Sony Ma. Till the end, she behaved like a mother. And there's an associate of mine, Bachchan. He is known to all the readers who have read my books. To him, in my absence, she used to tell, Sridhar is my beta. Isko koi bhi harm karne ko hota nahi. Nobody can harm him. By the time, Dawood was trying to get me killed. Charashetty was trying. Through, of course, one more Mr. Muthaparai. But she said nobody can touch him. Way back in 96. And though they tried, today everything is dissolved. So we discussed it. How many times you tried everything? They said at least for 10 years, every other day we were discussing of finishing you. All the top people, underworld people in India. But they were not able to come even 100 feet near me. And I don't say it was because of my intelligence or my guts or anything. It was because of a woman, a ma, like Sony Ma. Because she said, nobody can near you, you are my son. So if I start talking about it, it will take days, not hours. I have been writing about it. I am writing.
So after that riveting introduction to his life, to his early life, we'd like to unveil the cover of his latest book. So can I request Madhu to kindly... We have a few minutes left and we're going to spend a few minutes talking about Gangster's Geeta, right? His latest book, originally published in Kannada several years ago as Edegarike, made into a cult film, right? And now available in the English translation as The Gangster's Geeta. So the obvious question first, sir, and I also address this question to man after he has answered. Why this title, sir, The Gangster's Geeta?
Why Gangster's Geeta? Geeta is a metaphor. Geeta is a metaphor about what is right and what is wrong. Even in the underworld, thinking that what we are doing bad, people won't do it. Even the underworld people, they weigh all the options and decide that this is the path we have to take. This is the action we have to do. Even then, see, there happened a time in my life when some underworld gangster from Mumbai came to Bangalore to field against the then boss, Muthaparai. Then he assigned me the job of finishing him. And he spoke to Dawood Ibrahim. Dawood Ibrahim said, Udado isko. Does the work, he said. Though he was the henchman of Dawood, he worked with Dawood for 20 years. He interacted with Dawood like anything, like me and Pratibha. See, she is close to me since about 20 years. So the man said, gave the phone to Muthaparai after speaking to him. Udado isko, you only send him to act against Muthaparai. Then we took him to some place. And there, because of so many reasons, it was delayed by 2 nights. And Rai said, only you can handle him, he should be with you. And he started narrating his life. How the life was led in a wrong way, led in a wrong way. Then he came to know that I'm a well-read man. So he started expressing his affair. How many people he killed? He killed lots of people. He was a very big name. Very big name in the Bangalore, in India and the world, especially Mumbai. During that time, I established almost a kindly relationship with him, human relationship with him. I wanted him to escape. I did not like to see his death. Somehow I started hinting him. If he escaped, because I was the main person there. Somehow I'll manage my boss. I'll tell him he ran away. Somehow. He refused. He said, if I escape, I will be killed in the Mumbai more violently. And already his girl has given up. That shocked me. When I narrate it, people will be this one, because it is known to lots of us, lots of boys in the underworld. He refused. What started disturbing me after his killing was the way he faced his death. Very calm, he was very composed. With the extraordinary dignity he faced, he made us give him a dignified death. Till the last minute, we knew he will be killed. He knew he would be killed. Nobody discussed it. Even in the end minute, hey, dirty bastard, you get lost. No. It was done in such a peaceful manner because the character of that particular man who was in the underworld. What I tried to, it was disturbing inside me for a long time. The only way escape for me was to write about him, to bring the character in front of the people. It happened. At the same time, I wanted to tell in the underworld, even in the most violent, cruel circumstances, the human spirit remains. That made me right.
So, my question to you, ma'am. The process of translating this book, right? How is the style in Kannada? How were you able to transcreate it in English? Could you take us through that process? Because translating is not just translating word for word. You have to make the English reader alive to the possibilities of this wonderful text in Kannada. So take us through the process a little bit.
Thank you, Karthik. See, it was I'm quite nervous about it even now, even though it is printed. Because Mr. Sridhar's style of writing in Kannada is very, very distinct. He never uses flowery language for anything, though he has published 11 books and all of them are bestsellers. And reprints are available all the time, they are in demand. So even here, he never uses flowery language or very simple, short, straight sentences that just gives the picture. And you are into the book from the second sentence. In fact, in this book, you are into the story from the first sentence. It just starts like saying, it was not my decision, the boss had taken the decision. So immediately you are drawn into the story. And in Kannada, we are very used to it because what he is saying is we know what he is trying to say. And that nuance, the risk is that you will lose it in English. So how to put his style into English? See, I can make it verbatim translation, but still I may be losing a lot of it. So in fact, I should thank Karthik for helping me in this. And wherever we found that the English reader needed a little bit more, we asked Mr. Sridhar to add to that. So he gave a little more descriptive information about what he was talking about. So this is a book that once you read the first sentence, you cannot put down till the last sentence. That I guarantee you, because the narration is so good and you're drawn to it from the first sentence. And to bring it in English, I don't know what I have done, In fact, I'm quite nervous about it.
A little bit about, since I have worked with the text myself, you've quoted Albert Camus in several places. Am I right in assuming he's your favorite writer, or at least one of your favorite writers?
I don't think of Camus as a writer who influenced me. I think of him, I don't know how many of the audience have read Camus. He just shaped me since the age of 20 years. A great humanist. I consider him the modern prophet of Europe. He came into prominence during Second World War. The way he used to address French youth, German youth, and the youth in general, he shaped our lives. He told me what is true. He talks about the modern day Jesus. No, he does not talk, he infers. What should be modern day Jesus like? We talk about truth and the lies. When something is not there, we speak, it is a lie. When something is there, we say it is not there, it is a lie. No, he says, to make life simple, we use the language to exaggerate. His book, The Outsider, is an extraordinary work. It is in no way inferior to any religious or spiritual work. There he tries to invite the reader to question the way he employs his language. Yes, you are, I know, in the underworld, I knew the person sitting opposite me, whether I am his adversary or friend, I knew that we are just bundle of emotions inside us, bundle of feelings locked in your body. This is what Camus taught me. We are all bundle of feelings. Those bundle of feelings, when expressing in a language, we lose its shine, we lose its light, we lose its transforming power. He again and again insists about humanism. He says we should employ the words or the language for the service of truth. This is what in our Kannada Basava did. Again and again he says, what you say and what you do, let there be a proper relationship. It should not be like you do something and you are saying something else. No, this is what Gandhi said. This is what Buddha, all the people said it. But through his writings, through his works of art, through his long stories, short stories, Camus makes us believe it, makes us imbibe into it. Pratibha told one thing, that I never used a flowery language. I had all the chances to glorify underworld dealings and actions. But I thought, no. You look at any common journalist who writes about journal underworld, they say, he's a lone wolf, he's a tiger raja, she is a cheetah rani. No, it is not like that. You could have been underworld. That lady could have been the mother of any underworld man. So anybody could be like that. It's a question of situations. Ultimately, we are all either the slaves of situations or masters of situations. Most of the times when we come to underworld, we become the slaves of situations. Because, like I said, the main this one will be, consideration will be your life and your death.
So one last question before we throw it open to the audience. Indulge me please with this question. Do you read crime fiction? Who's your favorite crime writer?
I think about 30, 40 years ago I stopped. The last one was Godfather. I read it before entering the underworld. After entering the underworld, I made sure that I would not fall into that. I was reading mainly literature. I mean, also, Dostoevsky is my favorite author. Dostoevsky is my favorite too. I think of them as the guiding forces. Even today, you cannot find one criminal fiction in this one. And when Pratibha asked me to translate this, but I said, I lost all the interest. It looks as if it happened, all these things happened in my last life. There's nothing of it remains in me. So still I'm supposed to do it. I translated, so I don't read crime fiction at all. And I don't even see crime movies. Not because it will influence me. I lost the interest.
Sure. See, when Mr. Sridhar started writing about his experiences in the magazine, weekly tabloid Agni, I was working with him, and every week I used to feel very tense because he was absolutely frank. And whenever I asked him, sir, he would say, I want to demystify the underworld. And did he demystify in Kannada or even in English? I don't think there is any underworld don in the world who has written his own autobiography, made a film on it, and wrote the script and got the state award.
Audience, questions? It's not every day that you'll meet someone like him.
They can ask good, bad, ugly, any questions. Yes, please. Please, sir.
We have time for just two questions, so one question here and one more.
I'd like to ask you one thing. Have you not gone into the underworld?
Yeah. Very inspiring your story, though I'm not going to join the underworld. My question to you is that had you not gone into the underworld, would you still be writing, and what would be the context of your writings then?
No, it may look as if I'm glorifying myself and I've become a very great film director, very great writer, anything else except underworld man. I was not fit into it at all. I was an outsider.
But by going into it, you have produced some masterpieces. So for the others to get the insight into it.
It actually limited me.
Okay.
See, I have written a book about Basava. Nobody has such kind of discussion at all. It is a book I loved from my heart, with my entire being, with my entire spirit. Even today when I tell people, they don't even ask a single question about it. And all of them ask me about my days in the underworld. In Kerala, it's called Dadagiri Dinagalu. So it is so good. I feel so bad. No, nobody is talking to me that I could be able to speak about Basava or Shankaracharya or Gita. No, no one asks. It has limited me.
Thank you. Thank
one more question, please. Last.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Lady here. Right there. One gentleman wanted to ask.
Thanks for your talk and insight. From all I know or we've seen in the movies about Underworld, that Underworld is a point of no return. How did you get back out from it?
Because, like I said, first I was trained for something else. My father was a primary school teacher. He always taught me to live the life of truth. Even today when I go back, when I go to my sleep, no, I tell my father, I am sorry. I was not able to keep up the promise I made to you. During young ages, he used to tell me again and again and again that I should live the life of truth. So I entered into it after I developed my personality because of situations. Like I said, when my only brother was attacked, it is a fact. My brother is also here, and the thing is, he became the police officer. My life followed the arts. Arts is not created of my life. My life itself has become this one. And my mother never used to like my brother the way she liked me, because she thought I need all her love because I was jailed. She never used to like the police officer. It is almost like the film, a Hindi film had come long ago, Diwar. It is like that in my real life.
Can I add to that? See, when he decided to come to the mainstream, the police were very skeptical, you know. In fact, they would ask me also whether he himself is writing or whether what is the purpose of starting a magazine and how we are doing it. They thought it would be for extortion or something like that. So it took them also some time to understand that he was very serious about it and that he himself is writing. And the way, when he started really writing, and once in midway, he was arrested on fake cases and he was put in jail, and from the jail he used to send his editorials. So we called it editorials from behind the bars. But even those, he was very, he didn't play to the gallery like people would generally think. I think it took him 10 years to prove. So it was not an easy journey. Thank you.
So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Big round of applause for Agni Sridhar and Pratibha Nandakumar. Thank you. Wonderful being here.
Thank you so much.